Joining us now, here he is, Komal Sreekumar, president and investment strategist at Sreekumar Global Strategies, and Andrew Sliman is senior portfolio manager at Morgan Stanley Investment Manager. Mike Santoli joins us now on set. All right, Sree, here's what I was saying earlier. I don't know if you were watching. Your premise about lower yields, which you've been calling for years and years, going against the grain, has to do with the idea that growth was globally was not going to be strong enough to support higher yields, and we see the rest of the world some in negative. So that's always been it. But fundamentals seem to catch up with your overall viewpoint, even though you're not a technician. We had the China trade war got you another leg down in yields. Now we've got the coronavirus fears giving you another leg down in yields. You always based it on a sugar high from the tax cut, I think, in this country, in the United States. But it just seems to come into your purview, even though you didn't really forecast why it was going to happen. Do you understand what I mean? It happens, yeah. But not because of why you said it was going to happen.
Joe, I did listen to your conversation earlier in the hour with Becky. And in fact, continuing on the lines, I think the way in which the forecast come true is not fortuitous. It was not luck. What it comes for is a basic and a macroeconomic analysis, which says there are three components to the bond yield: expected real growth, expected inflation, and then the third element is global uncertainty or negatives, which cause people to go into safe havens. My view was that the first two components, namely the global growth as well as the inflation, simply would not pick up. I was going against the grain even in terms of those forecasts because, as you know, the consensus was that the global growth would pick up, the U.S. tax cut would be very effective. It is true. I said the U.S. tax cut would be a sugar high, but that's not the end of it. It also says that the Fed's policies will not cause inflation. American population is getting old and therefore is not consuming enough. And that structural change is not going to go away. Those are macroeconomic factors. Then, on top of that, I built into it a global influence. It could be a North Korean missile across Japan, for example. It could be a case of Iran-Saudi Arabian tension. And in this case, it just turned out to be the coronavirus. You cannot forecast the virus, but you have to build into your model the expectation that uncertainties such as of this type also contribute to pushing the yield down. Right. On the other side, I look to see what is the risk to the forecast. Would inflation pick up? Would economic growth surge? Or would the world become very calm again? And I didn't get an answer saying any one of those was likely to happen. That's why I felt very secure with my forecast for the last 3 years.
All right. And before we get back to, I want to ask you about, if we go below one, we might as well go negative, Sree. I mean, I don't know why you just don't go all the way with that forecast. Hopefully that's not going to happen. But Andrew, do you agree with what Sree is positing here?
I think the markets will rally off this. I don't think today. I mean, we'll have a bounce today, but I think that I'm an equity manager. And look, I think it's going to be a good year for equities. And if the market's a little down on the year, then this is a better time to buy than it was a couple weeks ago. But let's just keep it in calm here. The market's back to where it was at the beginning of the month. I mean, it was a big down day, but it was a big up day until Friday. So I think there's more weakness. These companies you talked about this morning with companies reporting, they've got to pre-report bad numbers. And so I think that's the next leg down. But at the end of the day, you know, you're talking about interest rates, but the reality is the dividend yield on the market's better than the 10-year. That's always been a pretty bullish sign for equities. And I think that's going to be the story. So to me, for equities, this is a better time to buy than it was a couple days ago, and I think it's going to be a good year.
If you just might go back to Graham and Dodd, I mean, you saw Home Depot, we were talking about a 10% dividend increase. If that keeps happening, dividends eventually just force the stock higher, especially with 1.37 on the 10-year.
Right. And the kind of stocks that have been working are the ones where the market said these are going to be sustainable cash flows that will be able to do dividends and buybacks for many years to come. Even stocks like Alphabet that don't have a dividend, but there's the potential there. Now, that being said, you do not, from an equity perspective, necessarily want to see the Treasury yields continue to make new lows. Yes, the backdrop of low yields helps support equity valuations. The relative yields look very good for equities. And I do think that that's going to be a prop for the market. And it was in 2016, and it was last year when we got to this position. But if the yields continue to make new lows, everyone's going to essentially say, we're in that late cycle vigil. We don't have enough kind of a backdrop of strong nominal growth around the world, even before these shocks, to get us out of it. So I do think it plays it both ways.
The other thing I would add here is last summer we had a China trade war issue. Rates dropped. Everyone ran into the safe trades. And then the market corrected and said, wait a minute, we're not going to have a recession. Rates bounced up. Value stocks actually rallied. And all those safe stocks or the safe trades sold off. So I think the point here is be wary of too much crowding into the safety right here. So
I'd like to go back to something Mike said a minute ago, and I fully agree with that. You have a period of falling bond yields, which is suggesting to you that the economy is not in good shape. I think the comparison between the S&P 500 dividend yields and the 10-year yield simply doesn't hold during that short term in which you have this concern about slowing growth and the inability of inflation to pick up. 10 years from now, I'm not going to be saying that the bond yields are going to remain low. But for the last 3 years, this feature has been repeated again and again, which is why the factor that the S&P 500 yield and the comparison with the 10-year yield simply does not mean that the equities are superior to bonds at this stage. Last point. If you look at what happened in the last two recessions, in 2001 and 2007, 2009, the equity markets, the S&P 500, reached a record high in December of 2007, at the time at which the recession began. So much for equities' predictive power. Whereas both in the 2001 and 2007 recessions, the 10-year yield, as well as the yield spread, clearly was predicting a recession, which is exactly what it's doing again today. And that is what is reflected in the bond market.